Hello and welcome to the Stronger, Leaner, Lighter show. Oh my goodness. This is probably one of the most important shows I've ever done, and I am so excited to introduce our guest, Diane Dimitriou. I'll be back in a moment where you will hear this incredible woman and what she's going to take on. Well, you know, they say a day is a long time in any way. Lately, it's an hour. I am super, super excited today to have this wonderful woman on the show. I want to introduce you all to Diane Dimitriou, and I'm going to just give you a little bit of a background into Diane before we go into me asking her questions. But she's a successful entrepreneur, leadership and mindset speaker, trainer, coach, and award-winning author of with over 40 years experience. I'll just say award-winning. She's written 12 books. Hold on, people. I think that's going to be another show. Experience in business and the corporate world. She began her career as an educator before she blazed a trail into the entertainment industry in radio, television, and on stage. She has owned two multi-award-winning businesses here and overseas, where even cyclones, corrupt governments, fleet groundings, and union interference couldn't stop her from leading these businesses into multi-million dollar success. Ooh, I just think that timing's perfect. Now Diane is taking on a new challenge, standing as a candidate for the next Australian federal election. And on this show, you're going to hear Diane's fascinating story and now why she's chosen to enter the often challenging world of politics at this time of immense change. Diane, welcome.
Thank you, Sally. It's absolutely a pleasure to be here today and to talk to all of your fabulous women out there. So it's great.
You know, we're going to create change. I honestly believe it's going to come from women.
Yes, I totally agree with you. It's time to actually increase the energy of compassion and kindness and collaboration and cooperation and of dominion rather than domination. So nothing wrong with men. Men are fabulous. We need men. But at the same time, we need to balance those energies. And as we're seeing more than ever, we're seeing a lack of empathy and understanding in our political leaders at this time. Oh, and we need that.
Couldn't agree with you more. I just love our colours, by the way. With every
aren't we? And it wasn't planned. There you go. So you've got to love. It's all serendipitous. It's all serendipitous.
Diane, you've had an incredible life. What I'm going to say is, people jump on, just give us a heart or a like. Just let you know as you hop on. I just let you know where you're calling in from or listening in from, and of course, we're going to be taking questions later. So as we go through, if you've got questions, we will get to them. But I want to hear Diane's story first and her reason why she's stepping up into federal politics. But please just ask questions as we go along. So your experience, you began well as an educator, but you moved into the entertainment industry. Explain to me a little bit about that.
Okay, so I'm going to go right back. I wiggled my nappy off at 2 to the music in front of the radiogram. Most people wouldn't even know what a radiogram is, but that's where I wiggled my nappy off. And my parents, my adoptive parents, made an inspired decision. And although they were very working class, they decided to send me to ballet school. And that was the beginning of a destiny made in heaven. And so I did all of my ballet training, became a ballet teacher and so on and so forth for many, many years. I had a wonderful love affair with the entertainment industry. And during that time, of course, back in those days, there was no NIDA. There were no professional schools that you could go and study entertainment. So at the same time as I grew older, I became a school teacher. But my great love had always been getting that big break. And so I kept moving through my entertainment career, and that big break came when I was chosen as the assistant director and choreographer at Jupiter's Casino for the first two multi-million dollar shows ever staged in Australia, Stars and Galaxies. So my life up until that time, the first 30 years of my life, showed me that dreams come true. And if it's meant to be, it's up to me. So I learned personal responsibility well and truly during that time. And everything was perfect. It was going wonderfully until I refused my producer's sexual advances and he sacked me for apparently being too fat. And so, yeah, so what happened was that I, of course, was quite indignant about this. And so I decided to stand up, stand firmly on my integrity. I drew a line in the sand and I went, no, that's not true. And I'm not going to tolerate this. And at that time, I could only take him to the Australian Conciliation and Arbitration Commission. That's all that was available to me. So off I went, and the commissioner found there were no grounds for my dismissal, and he reinstated me while the newspapers splashed dancer sack for being too fat across every front page newspaper in the country, because nobody before had ever challenged their producer on anything like this. This was way before the Me Too movement. So anyway, I was reinstated, and I was so naive. I went back to work thinking everything's good now and we'll all get on well and we can keep moving forward. But I didn't realise you couldn't put Humpty Dumpty back together again. So I progressively found the stress too much, and I took some time off on sick leave. He sacked me again on sick leave. I took him back to court again, because by then I was well and truly suited up. He'd picked the wrong girl, in my opinion. I went back to court. The commissioner found no grounds for my dismissal, but he was concerned at how I was being treated and my health, so he didn't reinstate me. So back in those days, there were no laws to protect anybody, so I lost everything. I got 4 weeks' pay in lieu of notice, and I lost a career that I had spent over 28 years training for and was the love of my life. But at that time, I had two choices. I could either commit suicide or I could dare to be more. And so that's what I did. And so I kept researching and looking and improving myself, taking again personal responsibility, doing the personal work. As they say, when you do the personal work, the professional work comes to you. And so that's what I did. And for the last 30 years, I've been on this journey of self-improvement and of giving people the opportunity to improve themselves and to be a way shower and to shine a light into situations to help people more than anything else. And that's why I've been coaching and then in my businesses, and it's just grown. So my reality grew around me at the same rate as I grew within. And so when I saw in this current situation, frontline workers and doctors and, you know, nurses and fire brigade and police officers and pilots and air crew all being discriminated against because of their own bodily integrity choice, I couldn't stay silent any longer. And I thought, I know how that feels. I've been there to be discriminated against and to lose everything through no fault of your own. And I thought, oh, dear me, we can't let this happen to Australia.
No, no. And I think, you know, if you've lived that experience, there's a passion that goes along with it, because you know what that feels like and how that feels to think, am I going to be able to put a roof over my head? Am I going to be able to feed my children? Am I, you know, like there's a totally different sense that comes from that when you've lived the experience.
Without a doubt. And one of the things that has really irked me through this whole thing is that all of these leaders have sat cashed up, getting their weekly paychecks and actually telling Australians how to live their life without taking on board any suffering whatsoever. They didn't even make a token gesture. They didn't make a token gesture and say, oh, we'll halve our wages just to see what it feels like. It's like walk in the other man's moccasins. You can't sit there and give yourself pay rises, which is just contemptuous. You can't sit there on the pay packet that you have and then, you know, point fingers at everybody else and say, you can't work. You have to stay home. You have to stay home and suffer more domestic violence. Your children have to be masked when they go to school. I mean, none of this is based on science. It's all based on control. In my opinion, it's all based on control, and we need to stop this.
Yeah. You know, I think that's really powerful. I think, you know, you look across a lot of what's happening, as you said, it's not based on science, and it makes no sense. It seems to be this arbitrary do this and then don't do that, and yet, you know, I know, I have my three children live in Canada. And my daughter is a journalist and, of course, quite active on Twitter. And she looks at what's happened here and she just shakes her head at what's going on here. She said, I don't think Australians realise what's actually happened. And it's this kind of small little things. It's just yes, 2 weeks to flatten the curve.
That saying of if you take a frog and you put it into a saucepan of water and you turn the heat up slowly, the frog will never jump out because it just slowly is boiled to death. But if you take the frog and throw it into a pot of water, it's out. And I hate to say it, but these politicians and leaders are treating us all like dim-witted frogs. Yes. They've got us in the pot and they're turning the heat up slowly but surely. And we become so compliant that we're actually putting up with it. We are going to boil ourselves to death. That's what's going to happen. It's the death of our democracy happening right now, right around us. And as I say to people, you can't comply yourself into freedom. Freedoms are our inalienable rights. No leader can give us freedom. That's our inalienable right. And as Australians, we have had those rights. My father in World War II fought to keep our freedoms. He'd be rolling over in his grave, as would any of that generation who was no longer with us. Absolutely. We've just become, seriously, we need to stand up, and this has got nothing to do with vaccinations, nothing at all, but that's what the government leaders and the media want to try and tell us, that it's a division between vaxxed and unvaxxed. No, it's not. We are all Australians. We have inalienable rights. And what we need to be doing is standing up together, shoulder to shoulder, and saying to our political leaders, we will not take this anymore. You have no right to do this. You can't lock up healthy people and call it quarantine or a lockdown. It's actually house arrest. And these politicians have had us under house arrest. And now Palaszczuk is about to do the same thing. And it's like... Where's the line in the sand, people?
Well, I think it was just drawn yesterday. I think the line in the sand was drawn yesterday. And I hope that people can start to see that this is much more than what it appears. Now, both you and I have done a lot of work around NLP and mindset and hypnosis. And it's interesting, isn't it? Sit back and watch as somebody who's worked in that field for a period of time to see what's actually playing out here, which is almost this mass hysteria, and I think that's what happened, is that people are not sitting back and looking at this objectively and saying, wait a minute, wait a minute. And of course, the minute people move into fear, they stop thinking. That's the stress response kicks in, flight, fight, or freeze. You can't think clearly. That's exactly what happens, and that's what's exactly going on. Diane, I wanted to ask you, why did you decide? I mean, I know you're passionate about this, but this is a big deal to step into the federal game. Yes. You have such experience in leadership and in business and as a 12 times author. What made you do this? What is it?
For 30 years, Sally, I've been meditating. I find meditation is an extremely valuable tool for overall health and well-being, and even more importantly, to connect to that essence of who we are. Some people call it soul, spirit. Some people call it God. I refer to it as consciousness, like our higher universal consciousness, and to make that connection, and in doing so, to actually find peace. Because unless we can live in peace within ourselves, there will be no peace on the planet. And as Mother Teresa said, silence is the cornerstone of all wisdom. And so meditation has been part of my daily practice. And it was during this pandemonium, I call it, this pandemonium that I was sitting and meditating. And at one time, it was only really a matter of weeks ago, I heard very clearly, you're going into politics. And I answered myself, no, I'm not. because I'm not a politician and I've never wanted to be one. And it was a very insistent nudge. And it was like, you're going into politics. And I went, no, I don't know, no. That was it. And it's what would be classed as a calling. I have been called to do this. And within a matter of, hours, I sat down at my my computer. I'd been looking at wonderful people like Craig Kelly, Malcolm Roberts, Pauline Hanson, Senator Gerard Rennick, all of these people standing up for freedoms and individual rights. And I'd been following them and watching them. And I went, well, if this is where I'm going, where am I going? Because I knew I wasn't going to be an independent. And within minutes, an ad came up or a post came up for the Liberal Democrats. And to be honest, I'd not heard of them. Like so many other people in Australia, I hadn't heard of them. And as I researched them and I looked at what they stood for, and I looked that they weren't that they weren't just a protest party, but a party of principles, that's when I went, right, this must be the one. And picked up the phone within a matter of days. I was going through a pre-selection process. And within a matter of a couple of weeks, I was endorsed. And here I am sitting as their endorsed candidate for Moncrief here on the Gold Coast, running in the next federal election, hopefully to be voted in to take a seat in the House of Representatives to stand up and be an advocate of the people for the people, because I'm still not a politician. And the lovely thing I loved about the Liberal Democrats is that they told me in my interview, we do not horse trade. And I thought, good, because I will not give up my principles and I will not give up my integrity for anything, for anything. And so that's why I chose them and that's why I'm doing what I'm doing. If we can get more candidates, and they don't have to be Liberal Democrat candidates, we need more candidates who have candidate integrity and honesty and truth into federal parliament, who will actually not be bought off, who will not be coerced, who will not be threatened, who will not be blackmailed and extorted. I don't know what's going on in there, but something seems to be going on in there because people are changing their colours all the time, changing their backflip, this, that. So I don't know what's going on in there, but we as voters need to vote in people that we feel aligned with, that will go in there and stand up and go, no, that is not democracy, that is not freedoms, that is not the Australian way, and that is not the legacy I want to leave for my children and my grandchildren. Because that really bothered me. I thought, I've lived this blessed life where I could go out and party and I could go to clubs and talk to people and all of these things. And now we're wanting to mask our children. It's like, what are we trying to do? Dumb down humanity? Mm-hmm. Is that what we're trying to do by cutting off their oxygen supply? I mean, is that the mission, to make us dumb and dumber? And I say to people all the time, if it doesn't feel right in your gut, if you've got a question that says, yeah, but why is that? Stop. Listen to it, pay attention, because your intuition, your common sense, your critical thinking is trying to tell you something. Don't ignore it. Don't ignore it.
So true. Can I ask, I mean, this is fantastic, Diane. This is like, where are our politicians saying this? They're not saying it. I mean, exactly. You're just, what you're doing is encapsulating, I think, how we feel. We elect these representatives. They work, they're supposed to work for us. And I think that's what's been lost here. They're strutting around, patting themselves on the chest, thinking that they're not listening to the majority of Australia. They're dictating. I want to ask you this question. Why the Liberal Democrats? And you and I have had this conversation, so I'd like it. And it comes down to this. One of the things you talked about is freedom and liberty. And this, we don't have a Bill of Rights, do we?
No. And that's what really bothered me when I started to look into all of this. I thought, how can these politicians do this as far as the Constitution? And then when I read the Constitution, which is really more of a governance document, and then there was no Bill of Rights, I was gobsmacked. I thought, oh, dear Lord. And here we are. And you see, the thing here is that as Australians, we have truly lived a wonderful, carefree, she'll be right mate, mm-hmm. life. Until mm-hmm. now, we've had no real war in our generation.
No.
And we don't even know when war is being perpetrated upon us, particularly if it's a cognitive war, particularly if it's subtle, and as I said, like the frog. So anyway, the Liberal Democrats, to me, they stand for individual freedom, free markets, and small government. I liked that. Mm-hmm. And I also liked their particular statement that they regard the government as the principal threat to these values. And as a party, they seek to reduce the intrusion of the government, which I particularly liked, into our lives, to mm-hmm. the lowest level possible, consistent with the preservation of a civilized society. As I was told, the government should stop at the curb. We should all be free to live our own lives past the curb in our own homes.
Excellent.
And the Liberal Democrats also, one of their aims is to restore to the individual the right to make their own choices and to accept responsibility for their consequences mm-hmm. on the basis that they make better decisions than the government. And this is what I was talking about before. If it's meant to be, it's up to me. We should not have a government telling us we must do this, we must have this, we must follow. And if we don't follow, they're going to take off freedoms that they've got no right to take off us. To me, it's not about vaccinations. They've started with that, but then it will be something else. And it's all chipping away. It's all eroding our freedoms until eventually, with this new digital identity bill that they're wanting to bring across the line, it's suspiciously like a social credit system where all of your details will be on there. Everything, your bank account, all of your medical records, everything that identifies who you are as a sovereign being will be on that one card. It'll all be cashless. We won't have credit cards. It will all be on that one card. And what's happening now in China is that if you don't obey the state, you can't get money out. You can't go anywhere. And so I say, particularly to voters in Moncrief, how's that going to feel when you turn up at the petrol pump and you've already used your quota of gasoline this week, and you go to get more fuel in your car and you can't pay for it? Mm-hmm. And people say, oh, no, you're just being far-fetched. That's very dystopian. Look around, everybody. Yes. Aren't we already sitting in a dystopian nightmare that we never thought this would happen? I say to people, consider back to Christmas 2019. Mm-hmm. What were you doing? Mm-hmm. What were you thinking? What mm-hmm. was happening in your world? Did you ever think we'd be here? Mm-mm-mm-mm. Never.
Well, I remember New Year's Eve 2019. We were celebrating with friends of ours on the 30th floor of an apartment building, the Surfers Paradise, with this view where we saw fireworks fire coming down the coast. We're all dressed up. Isn't this going to be great? Like the 2020 and best years of our lives coming up. And then up popped, I remember on my phone, this thing about pandemic. I thought, oh, what's a pandemic? Oh, whatever. And didn't even think about it until that first lockdown came. And I thought, what? This is rats. And of course, we all went, oh, well, we'll just go home and bake bread, you know, make cakes and it'll be fun. Let's paint our houses or write some books. And then it just kept rolling on. Now, we, as you have lived overseas, and I always look at Australia as this free country. Yes. You know, I used to say to people all the time, and I loved when I lived in Canada, absolutely loved it. It was a fantastic country to live in. And my children are all there. They've all gone back, bless their cotton socks. But you always looked and people would say, oh, my gosh, I can't wait to come to Australia. It's free. You can, you know, like the weather's fantastic. The people are lovely. We can do whatever we like. And then, bam, 2020. And it's like, hold on a minute. What are you doing to us? But, you know, Diane, I want to ask you this question. We are such a laid-back race of people.
Mm.
I mean, what do you think is going to take for people to say, what is it?
I have a feeling that lines have been crossed in the sand. Mm. I'm hoping that more people will realise and use their critical thinking skills and just take a step back, as you said before, and go, is this truly necessary? Because, you know, we need to ask ourselves, is this necessary? Is it safe? And what are the repercussions? And so if we are going to live our life on fear, and this is what this has been, it's been a well-orchestrated fear campaign. And if you notice, no other side of the narrative has been allowed. Any contrary narrative has been shut down. And that always bothers me. If we can't have an open debate from both sides of any argument, that means that we are being controlled and our minds are being manipulated to only see one side. That bothers me for a start. And that was my first question. Where is the other side of the narrative? Why aren't we hearing from other scientists, other virologists, other research? Why aren't we hearing that? And that was when my antenna first went up, because I thought, because there's something more than health. If this was truly about public health, why aren't we getting health messages? For example, eat better, cut down on your alcohol, get more exercise, get out and get vitamin D from the sun. Instead, they want to lock us away from vitamin D. They want to lock us down so that we can't exercise. They want to do all of these things to diminish our mental health and to diminish our psychological resilience. And again, I ask, why? Because if this truly is a pandemic, would the messages be about health? Get healthy, raise your immune system, let's lift ourselves up. And we get none of that. It's all this quick fix, and we've become a society of quick fix, and we haven't taken enough responsibility for our health. And so I encourage everybody to just question. I mean, everybody has the freedom of choice to do what they want. If they want to be part of the vaccination program, that's your choice. And congratulations. If people don't wish to be part of the vaccination program because it's still in its clinical trial stage, if they don't wish to be part of it now, that doesn't make them an anti-vaxxer. They're just possibly waiting to see what more long-term data results come back. So both cases have their own advantages and disadvantages. But the key here is that everybody should have a personal choice. The freedom of medical choice should not be taken away from them, and we should not be coerced, bullied, incentivized with sausages and schnitzels. Truly, if the pandemic was that bad, we wouldn't have to be offered sausages and schnitzels. And we should
$1 million.
Yes. And we shouldn't be ostracized and go, oh, you can't join society. I often want to say to these people, well, if the people who choose not to be part of the clinical trial, are you going to let them off paying taxes and rates and everything else? Because if you're going to ostracize them from the society, you should not expect them to pay either, because that's not fair. But these
I'd just like to say, if anybody's listening and agrees with that, just give a like or
I'm not telling you to do that. I'm just saying that that would be my conversation with the government leaders, because you can't have your cake and eat it too. That's fair.
That's exactly right. And I think what you, I mean, the key in all of this is personal choice and personal freedom. And if you feel, as many we know, you and I both know, of people who are extremely stressed at the moment, extremely uncomfortable, having to make a decision they don't want to, because everything, and these are not silly people. They're people who have done, you know, asked questions, done research. And, you know, the thing about all this is, talk about science. You know, you hear some of the great scientists talk about, that's what science is. It's continually questioning. And one of my guys that I love to follow, Dr. Zach Bush, he said the whole point of science is to make an assumption and then be proven wrong. That's what scientists do. I make an assumption, I come based on my research. That's why every study says further research is needed. But if all those people who have been shut down, I remember an interview with Dr. Bruce Lipton, who was a medically, who trained doctors, said, I'm being silenced. I can't believe it. What? Now, these people are well-trained, experienced, and when we're not getting that other side, that's when you question what's really going on, because we all are intelligent individual people. And
exactly.
we talk about being sovereign. I mean, being sovereign is taking all the information. Most people are making decisions based on what's right for them and their families. We should never take that away.
That's correct. And it is very unfair. And when they say, oh, it's not mandatory, I'm sorry. For taking everything away from you to force you to have a procedure that you are not convinced about or that you're hesitant about is making it mandatory. It's just so unfair for Australians, hardworking, good-natured, trusting, willing Australians to have to make this choice. And I'll come back to it one more time. Why is this happening when the coronavirus, if you contract it, and if you are a healthy, normally healthy human being, you have a 99.98% recovery rate? So for me, there are too many unanswered questions with this. Yeah. And my big thing is that our liberties, our freedoms, our ability to make our livelihoods and to provide a good life for ourselves and our family are being dictated to by government leaders who are not suffering whatsoever. They just continue on their merry way. And I just think our democracy is slipping into dictatorship. It's obvious with these draconian measures.
And I think I think that's a really good point for those watching who have been struggling through these lockdowns. And, you know, now we've got issues with supply chains and the cost of petrol, you know, ridiculous price. And I know in England at the moment, the cost of heating is just going through the roof. I
mean, that's another topic. That's net zero. Don't get me started on that one.
But this is where, you know, like the results of these things have got long-term ramifications.
Yes.
For businesses in particular are going to take years to recover, all while the politicians continue to get paid their money and receive their benefits.
Correct.
And so many people are not getting that. I think that's a really key point for us. No matter what, where you stand on this issue, it's just look at where have these people mandating these measures, where are they suffering? Where are they under stress? Where are they worrying about how they're going to feed their children tomorrow? Where are they worrying about how to pay the electricity bill? Where are they worrying about how to pay their petrol, put petrol in their car? I mean, we live on the Gold Coast. There's a lot of people here who travel to Brisbane and back every day.
Yes.
And now their costs for just getting there and back, it's probably going to cost them an extra, I don't know, $30, $40 a week, which is a huge thing when you've got children and school fees and everything else going up.
Absolutely.
Diane, this has been fantastic. I before we finish up, I just want you to say, to just give us an indication of if you get elected, what will be your first thing? What will be your first thing you do day after whenever Scott Morrison calls the election and you're off to Canberra? Let's hope it's summer. You're easing gradually.
One of the things I'd like to do, and this is also part of the Liberal Democrats Party policies, is that we want a Royal Commission on three different things. We want a Royal Commission on politicians, police, and bureaucrats regarding Australia's COVID response. And I know a lot of people say, oh, more taxpayer money wasted on Royal Commissions, but at this point in time, that's all we have at our disposal. And we want to get to the bottom of why the COVID response in Australia has been made and the politicians, the police and the bureaucrats behind all of this. Because really my intention of moving into federal parliament is to ensure, however I can, that this never happens again. I want that Bill of Rights. That could take long, long time to get implemented. And a lot of people have said, oh, well, it's probably not worth it. You know, they said that back in the late 1970s when there was discussion of getting a Bill of Rights and everybody sort of shrugged back then and said, oh, well, it's not worth it. So for me, my legacy would be to leave Australia constitutionally in a better state than it is now, that is more transparent. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And that nobody could actually do this again. We have to secure our democracy and our legacy for our children so that they don't have to go through this. And that's what I would do. And I've been a great believer as a leader that the most important thing you can have with your teams, with your colleagues, with your stakeholders, whatever it happens to be, and in this case, the Australian people, is trust in any mm-hmm. relationship. Trust mm-hmm. is a tenuous thread. You break the trust, very hard to get it back, as we all know if we've had that broken in our relationships. And I feel that the Australian people have been betrayed. Trust has been broken. And I am one of those people who believes in truth and transparency. And I wear my heart on my sleeve, and I know that my political opponents are going to come crashing in at me about that, because I am open, I'm authentic, and I will tell it as I feel it is from my heart. And I think it's time that we have more people serving the people in government who are willing to do that and to be honest. And if that means we shoot ourselves in the foot sometimes, we need to have the courage and the compassion to step up and say, sorry, I made a mistake. But at the same mm-hmm. time, the Australian public have to actually be willing to stop discrimination against their neighbour, discrimination and blaming and shaming. And we need to bring humanity. We have to bring the human back into humanity here in Australia. And I'd like to be part of that.
Wow. Well, yes, everything, yes. And I think the key word you use there was authenticity. That just ran like an electric shock through my body. That's what we're missing so much of. Yeah. Authenticity. It's not about towing the party line. And, no. You know, you listen to interviews with politicians and they do this double speak that says nothing.
No,
and it just frustrates the hell out of me. Just answer the freaking question, but they don't. Oh, no, we're just going to make sure we're on the hearing to policy. Diane, you're such a breath of fresh air. I am so glad you listened to your intuition and your meditation. I mean,
thank
how
you.
Good is that?
Well, I'm going to give it a good run. So if you're in Moncrief and you want some honesty instead of hypocrisy and some truth instead of all this, you know, double speak, you know, pop me up the top of the ballot. And if you want to actually stop what's going on, you have to put the major parties at the bottom of the ballot, because they really are in collusion with each other. We need more of these minor parties who are all talking about freedoms, liberties, and democracy. We need them up the top of the ballot. We need more of us in Parliament. Then we can really make change.
Oh, I can't agree with you more. And, you know, this is, and you and I have discussed, this is the most important election, I believe.
Absolutely.
In my
Absolutely.
Lifetime. This is, as you say, for your children and for our grandchildren. I want my grandchildren to know I stood up. I want them to know that I did something.
Yes.
Because there'll come a time when, you know, I've got, heaven knows when, a grandchild on my lap. But I want to be able to say, Grandma, did you stand up? And say, yes, I did, honey. I
Absolutely. And that was something that really, really, you know, went into my heart, is that I will not be one of the last generation of free Australians. I will not do that. I will not die with regret that I just stuck my head in the sand and pretended it didn't happen.
Yeah.
And so that's why I'm doing what I'm doing. And it is, and I say to people, people have been voting and living by default. That's what's been happening for decades, because we've had it so easy and so good, basically across the board. I don't mean to say that everybody's lived a blessed life, but Australia as a whole lived a very blessed existence. Yeah. And so we've lived and we've voted by default. We just tick a box and off we go without realising that politics rules our life. And so we're now seeing that politics does rule our life. Mm-hmm. And so if we want better politics, we've got to choose better people. And that's why I say to everybody, please become critical about this next election and look at what's going on, look at who you want, and make your vote count. This is absolutely so fundamental to the future of Australia. Your vote needs to count this time, and realise, don't toss it away. It's one of the most precious things you currently have. It's really precious this time around. So if you've been somebody who's gone, yeah, whatever, tick, or if you've been somebody who goes, I think they're all lies and cheats, and you just don't do an informal vote, not this time, because we've got the governments we've got because of how we voted.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And we are, you know, I've always been one for, I agree with compulsory voting, because I've lived in a country where it wasn't, and people don't care. They don't care. And you look at the amount of money that's spent in other countries. I mean, we spend a lot of money in elections too, but places like the US to get people out to vote. I mean, it's just extraordinary. We have a great system here. Flawed as a little bit, it can be, but we have the right, we have the ability. And, you know, we are influential sovereign women. We have to step up. And I'm so pleased to be able to support you. I know many of our people, many of us will be supporting you. You are a breath. As Jen just said, we need more of you in politics. It's so true. We need, and well done to you too. What a breath of fresh air. Fabulous interview. Thanks, Jen. Yeah, I'm a passionate, I've always been passionate about politics. We love politics in our family. But now I'm just, okay, we are, this is it, people.
I totally agree with you. This is it.
You can do something.
Yes, and this is the one, because if we just vote back in the duopoly that we currently have, things will only get worse. Will only get worse. We'll have digital ID cards, we'll have social credit systems, we'll have a totally segregated society, we'll be bringing in immigrant workers to work everywhere, because a third of our society, like our nurses and so on and so forth, and I think it's probably closer to a third than 20%, will all be ostracised, and they'll be just cast aside. And we can stop all this now. We could stop all this now if we stood together and said, no, we don't want to live like this. We don't want to ostracise our friend or our neighbour or our colleague or our family member because they make a different choice to us. We've never done it before. We've all been educated that we are supposed to be tolerant of everybody's religion, of everybody's gender, of everybody's everybody's station in life. So why has it changed now?
And that's who we are as Australians.
We're welcoming
people. We have embraced multiculturalism. We've embraced, people from all different walks of life. You know, I remember the most fabulous day, two days that stand in my mind was the day that Kevin Rudd issued the apology to the Indigenous people of Australia, the most emotional day of my life. I don't think I stopped crying. And the other day I didn't stop crying was when we made same-sex marriage legal. I mean, we are a great country. That's what we do, you know. We support each other.
Yes.
Dividing us. After everything we've been through as a country, and as you're right, you know, I had my grandfather fought in the Second World War and my uncle died in the Second World War, they would be rolling over right now thinking, what did I do that for? My grandfather was 2 weeks tracked by a sniper trying to keep the Japanese out of this country and give us the freedoms that we've just taken for granted, and it's our line in the sand. This has been amazing. Now,
thank you.
I know a lot of people are watching the replay, so if you've got further questions, pop them in after the replay, after the show, and Diane and I will come back and answer those. But I ask you to reach out to Diane. We'll put all Diane's contact details. Reach out to her if you are in Moncrief.
Or anywhere. I've got people reaching out to me from across the country because they're just so overwhelmed. So understand I'm an advocate of the people for the people. I'm running in Moncrief, but that doesn't mean that I won't help you if I can, no matter where you live. So.
Right. And let's get involved, people, in this election. Get involved. Make your votes count where you can help, whether that's knocking on doors, whether that's handing out brochures, whether that's standing there. We can do something. Diane, this has been absolutely brilliant. I am so excited for this next period of time.
Thank
you're
Sally.
Such a breath of fresh air. It's like I can go, oh, shoot, we've got somebody on our side, things like that.
Yes.
We will talk soon. Thank you, everybody, for being on the show. Thanks for commenting.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much. And hang in there. Hold the line. We will make sure democracy stays well and truly afloat here in Australia, without a doubt.
Brilliant. Thanks, Diane. See you soon.
Okay. Thank you, Sally. Bye-bye.